bag or two. Now ain't you sorry, little gal, that my new little girl ain't you.
I think it's go time.
I think we're live.
Yeah. Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Mac Naylor, and I serve as President and CEO here at the National World War I Museum and Memorial, and we're delighted to have you here. So thank you for taking time out to be here, and for those online, we're so grateful, too, that you're joining us. I think that we're in for a treat for this conversation about protection and detection chemical warfare. We have a distinguished panel with us this evening. To my left is Dr. Ron Trewyn. He's the Kansas State University's liaison to the National Bio-Agro-defense Facility. Dr. Trewyn was formerly a staff sergeant in the U.S. Army Infantry in Vietnam and later earned a doctorate in microphysiology from Oregon State University. As a member of the National Cancer Institute's Comprehensive Cancer Center, His research focused on human cell changes that can aid in cancer detection and treatment. Trewyn has been an Associate Vice Provost for Research and Professor of Biology at Kansas State University, served as President of the KSU Research Foundation, and was Dean of the Graduate School. Join me in welcoming Ron.
Thank you.
And immediately to my left is General or President Richard Myers. Retired U.S. Air Force General Richard Myers is the Kansas State University president. He graduated from the university and joined the Air Force through the K-State's ROTC program. From 2001 through 2005, he served as the 15th chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff and was the principal military advisor to the U.S. President, Secretary of Defense, and the National Security Council. As a command pilot, he received numerous awards and decorations for his service, including the French Legion of Honor, the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Please join me in welcoming Dick Myers. And to my right is Dr. Tom Sack. Tom is the MRIGlobal's President and Chief Executive Officer. Dr. Sack has been with MRIGlobal since 1985 and has been responsible for major research operations, partnerships, and strategic planning. An expert in the chemistry and detection of chemical warfare agents, Dr. Sack has co-authored more than 50 publications and technical papers and is an advocate for science education. Please join me in welcoming Tom. The use of poison gas is one of the two most striking images from World War I. The other being trench warfare. It is a weapon of war that continues to be used today. In late 1914, with forces dug in, the Germans planned the first use of chlorine gas, selecting the Allied held town of Ypres in Flanders, Belgium. Writing in his memoirs, Infantry General Berthold von Diemling wrote, "Falkenhayn revealed to us that a new weapon, poison gas, was to be used, and that my corps area has been selected for the first attempt. The poison gas would be delivered in steel cylinders, which would be built into the trenches and opened when the winds were favorable. I must confess that the commission for poisoning the enemy, just as one poisons rats, struck me as it must any straightforward soldier. It was repulsive to me. If, however, the poison gas were to result in the fall of Ypres, we would win a victory that might decide the entire campaign. In my view of this worthy goal, all personal reservations had to be silent. So onward, do what must be done. It was necessary and knows no exception. On April 12, 1915, with a wind blowing from the northeast, the gas was released from the 5,730 buried cylinders, forming a cloud about 5 feet high and drifting toward the Allied trenches. Within 2 hours, the French and Algerian troops, were overwhelmed by the gas, two divisions of about 10,000 men collapsed. By the time of the end of World War I, the major combatants used more than 124,000 metric tons of 21 different toxic agents, delivered by some 66 million artillery shells, approximately 1 million casualties on both sides, about 90,000 were fatal, and many left wounded and disabled. Tom, what would have been the experience of those in 1915 who were subject to this first chlorine attack?
Well, that's an excellent question. The first thing they would experience is probably fear and shock and surprise, because they would, the first thing they would experience would be burning of their eyes, coughing, their throat would be scratchy and burning. Over time, it'd probably get them to where their chest would hurt. They would, and depending on the dosage that they got, their lungs could start to fill up with water. They would asphyxiate themselves either by the lack of oxygen or just by their reaction to the chlorine. But whatever it was bad, and it was sinking down into the trenches where they all were. And I'm sure they had no idea what to do, and they were extremely scared as they went forward. And then I'm sure eventually many of them, as you said, collapsed and were overcome.
The stories, the accounts of that first event, talk about the soldiers firstly thinking it was smoke that was coming, and so standing ready to receive the troops who would be running to them, only to find that there were no troops that came, but in fact then they experienced as you have described, and then those some miles away, some hour, probably hours later, heard the terrifying screams as the troops ran, or many on horses racing then to the outlying perimeters, where then they would rise, some of whom would die, but then they were confronted with this awful experience, this first time the chlorine then was used, and the consequences of that, of course, are just so profound. So we talk about the terror and the fear, as well as the physiological response. In part of your work, you visited Edgewood Chemical and Biological Center, Canada's Suffield or Dugway, the proving ground where chemical agents were researched, prepared, and stored. Talk to us about what it's like then to be in that environment where, in fact, there are, or there have been, these agents.
Yes, indeed. So the picture you see there is at Dugway Proving Ground, which is in Utah. It's about a couple hours from Salt Lake. And what you see is the test grid. So that's where they can release chemicals and then watch how they flow downwind and detect them with various detectors and collectors. They no longer do live agent testing at Dugway. We can't do that on the continental U.S. any longer. But when you visit a place like Dugway or Edgewood, the first thing you think about is this is where they tested live chemical agents. And you're walking in buildings and in laboratories where people had been developing and testing chemical warfare. I found it very sobering. Every time I'd walk on, Edgewood strikes me the most just because it's got such an old look to it, and I think Dick would agree with that, that it's, you know, it's been there a long time. You go through double fences with lots of, you know, razor wire, and it feels pretty secure, and so.
So this photograph here, you talk about the way in which the wind carries the gas. which of course in World War One was, in the first, particularly the first usages, gas would often blow back on the troops.
Yes.
And so timing the release of gas, expecting it to be carried away, was part of the strategy. Yes.
That's right. And in they tested in Dugway and some other places because the wind would set up in a nice, every day it would set up blowing in the same direction. But unfortunately at Dugway, and many of you probably know that they had an incident where the weather did not cooperate back when they were doing some agent testing, and they ended up killing thousands of sheep downwind because there was an inversion or something that carried the droplets of the agent where they weren't supposed to be.
I don't know. That was a long time ago, right? In the 60s or 70s?
Yeah.
I remember seeing the story, and they had these sheep farmers had their pictures of their sheep, and they were all on their back with their legs in the air, and the government was denying, well, this couldn't have been, they were right next to Dugway, but no, this couldn't have been Dugway. We weren't doing anything. But the whole field of sheep were all, all dead.
But what have we got happening here?
So this is the inside of a laboratory. So this is an example of a laboratory where you may be handling chemical agents or biological agents where you don't know what you're handling is a live agent or not, and so you have
to use... So it's like a blind test?
That's right. So you have to have maximum containment in a situation like this, and so the staff are, in this case, it's a mobile laboratory, and those of you that heard Dr. Gray talk a couple weeks ago talked about some of these labs. So it's pretty crowded in there, and you get a bunch of people in those suits, and they're hot, and they're trying to figure out, well, do I have a live agent or not? To support getting information out in the battlefield. And those are some examples. So this is a happier bunch of them there.
That's after the fact, right?
Right. But again, these are some of the laboratories that we described a couple weeks ago where we've deployed them, and the idea there is you can look at and do chemical forensics or biological forensics in the field very close to where you need the results. And that's an example. So that's from Edgewood Arsenal. And that's a laboratory that we helped construct, and it was designed to handle the newest generation of chemical warfare agents. So as you can tell, there's a lot of glove boxes. None of the materials are out in the open. It's high containment. It's a very complicated facility where several people they use to test detection, collection, decontamination of some of the newest chemical agents. Some of those, and we may talk about that later, may have been involved in the UK here recently.
Right, good. We will. We'll come back to that. Ron, the new National Bio-Agro-Defense Facility is planned for Manhattan, K-State, and you're responsible for the liaison with that. Talk to us about why we need that. What's its role?
Well, a number of things, but basically the U.S. does not have any adequate facilities these days to really look at biological agents, especially those for which there's no treatment or minimal treatment. So there are many types of diseases around the world. Ebola is something that's been in the news most recently, but there are a lot of other ones out there that there is no facility currently in the U.S. where if livestock, cattle, sheep, pigs, goats, are susceptible to these diseases, where you can actually do the work on them in a large-scale sort of situation. So there's an antiquated lab at Plum Island, New York, where they work on essentially one foreign animal disease, but almost all of the current pandemic threats in the world are zoonotic diseases, those that spread from animals to people. There is no facility where you can really work on those at the level that you need to. We happen to have one at Kansas State where we're doing some of that work, but NBAF is a replacement for the Plum Island facility, and one where if it's an untreatable zoonotic disease where they can actually have the space suits, the similar sorts of things that used for chemical agents, but to protect the workers while developing new vaccines, new countermeasures, new detection methodologies.
Good. And we'll talk in a little while about what some of those might be, right, and what the risks are to us. During the Cold War, Dick, you had to operate within a chemical warfare environment. Talk to us about sucking rubber.
Okay, so we'll talk about sucking rubber in just a minute, but the context is, chemical weapons of mass destruction really started in World War I. That's the chemical weapons we've been discussing. And ever since then, there were attempts to prohibit their use in warfare. And it didn't occur until the Chemical Weapons Convention in 92, I think, that was signed in 93, that we finally got there. And countries either ratified it, signed up, and started destroying their stockpiles. But in the Cold War, we had to plan to fight actually in a chemical weapon environment, which meant that we'd have fairly bulky suits, mainly charcoal-based clothing that would filter things that would come towards your skin. And then the sucking rubber came from wearing a gas mask for 12 hours. And when you took that rubber mask off, you felt like you'd been eating it. And trying to do what you do in wartime in that mask. We had different masks for air crews, elaborate procedures. If it was very hot out, that we would have a place where you could go and decontaminate, rest, hydrate, and then get back out either on the flight line or in the air or wherever your duty was or out with the troops. It was, we spent an awful lot of time in all our inspections. My guess, we have some veterans here that probably experienced that. I don't know if we called it sucking rubber in the Air Force. I don't know what the Army would call it. I hate to think probably, but don't want to know. But that was our expectation, that we would have to fight in a chemical warfare environment. So we practiced really hard at that, in donning our equipment, in going through decontamination after we were off shift, and we had all sorts of elaborate procedures. The first Gulf War, very elaborate procedures for where we'd be fighting, where we would be resting, and trying to have clean spaces and spaces that we knew would be dirty, potentially, quite, and how we wash down equipment. It's quite an elaborate thing we were trying to do just to deal with chemical weapons. I mean, it really drove our efficiency.
So then, in
lack of.
Yeah, really. In leadership, then, you're firstly, you're working in the experience of wearing the suits and stuff, and you yourself get to experience that as well. But talk to us about then, as a leader, as a planner, strategist, in working with the whole operations of the military, what were your concerns around chemical agents and biological agents?
Well, of course, you're concerned for the troops and ultimately the effectiveness of the military units. And when we went into Iraq, we went in there anticipating that we would be subject to chemical weapons, perhaps biological weapons. So it's interesting. One of the things that kind of drove the decision by the president to go into Iraq when he decided to go was the weather. Because if it's really, really hot and you have to wear these suits that are extremely hot, it would really cut down, particularly on the ground troops, on their efficiency and could bring physical harm. So I think the date was, what, March 19th. But anyway, it was that sort of drove that date as opposed to waiting until that fall because it gets really hot in that part of the world. Shortly thereafter.
What's the difference when you're working with troops and we're needing to talk about the use of chemical and biological agents? What's the psychological impact with troops compared to more traditional warfare?
Well, we'd been doing it for so long, for decades.
Perhaps it's hard to even make a distinction.
Yeah, it was just, okay, this is going to keep us safe. Thank you very much. We know how we're going to do this. And we'd studied all kinds of weapons and their dispersion, and they were bad, but if you were careful, there was a pretty good chance you could survive. But it took a lot of logistics to get to that survival piece. Mm. And is this the time to talk about anthrax at all?
We'll come back to that.
Okay. A lot of fun stuff we could talk about.
Yeah. So one of the things that strikes me when we hear about the use of chemical agents is even this week alleged. So that's sometimes used, Tom. Mm-hmm. It seems that there's not a certainty like one would expect. Talk to us about the challenges of detecting, and also the challenges of the researching of chemical agents. How do you do that? Mm-hmm. And the role of MRIGlobal. I think MRIGlobal is probably an organization that few people have an awareness about. So talk to us about that, the complexities.
Sure. With the Syrian attack just this last week, so we got news there was a gas attack pretty quickly that there was some sort of chemical attack going on. And the difficulty there is that the patients present themselves, and these patients, the symptoms that we've heard are symptoms that are consistent with chlorine contamination, much like the World War I, but also with nerve agent. And so the first reports were being very coy and, well, we it's chlorine or it's not. They could smell chlorine, but there's other things going on. So the trick is, it's all symptomatic, because the problem is chlorine blows away, and so now all you have left are the patients presenting themselves and what they look like, and people saying it smelled like chlorine. Nerve agents,
but it no longer smells because it's been blown away.
That's right. And then the nerve agent itself, they are not very stable. So unless you get there right away, the odds of you collecting it and detecting it exactly, the smoking gun or the actual gun, is very difficult to do from a chemical point of view. So again, you're in this mode of, well, the patient had these symptoms. They can do now. There are some advanced techniques to use body fluids, and you can detect metabolites or markers of nerve agent exposure, but it's really hard to do. And so the current, now, I was just reading right before I came just to see if they've ever figured out what they think it is. The best I can tell is they either used a mixture of chlorine and sarin, or nerve gas, or they used chlorine and then sarin, or some combination of the two. Right. But it's very difficult to do that, and that's one of the big challenges of proving that a chemical agent has been used, because most of them don't hang around long enough for you to collect.
Right.
And oftentimes the theater of operation is such you can't get there quickly right after. No one's going to let you in.
Yeah.
And so that's one of the challenges that we face. And that's one of the reasons, for example, for MRIGlobal, we've worked on mobile laboratories. So you can have a mobile laboratory, let's say on a military base, where you can get a sample there very quickly versus days and days to get back to the United States and get some information to let you know what really happened, so you know how to treat the people, how you can deal with any munitions you may have found, and that sort of thing.
So does MRIGlobal play a role in that detection work and the doing the studies and the analysis?
Yes, we do. So for a number of years, we've developed methodologies for how do you detect the chemical agents, how do you detect things that are related to them, such as their precursors, or what do they decompose into, so that if you run across a suspected environment that they may have used a nerve gas, you can collect a soil sample. You won't detect the nerve gas, but you might detect what it decomposes into. Mm-hmm. And we've developed a number of methods for that. In extension, then, putting them into mobile laboratories, the same methodologies that we would do in our laboratories, you put them into mobile labs that you could take out to the field to use just right next to the soldiers. Mm.
You ask about, what do you worry about as a commander? When you command a wing or something of that size, what we always worry about is exactly what you were just talking about, which is surveillance. Are you under attack, or is that just a smoke cloud that is harmless? And if you're under attack, what is the agent or agents you have to deal with? And we never had the kind of equipment reliably that could ever tell us that, as long as we were still doing that up till the 90s. We had lots of devices in the field that were trying to help. I'm sure MRI put some stuff together. Some of it was good for pieces of the spectrum of the threat, but not everything, and it was difficult then. How do you deal with stuff? You can't even characterize it.
Well, in the years ago, the early days, and they had just paper, and I think it was M8 paper is what they call it, but if an agent got on it, it would change color. But that's too late. Well, it changed color and I'm sick. That's kind of how it works.
Yeah.
But to your point, there's detection devices today for the chemical agents. This is not true for the biological agents that can identify them fairly quickly.
We're pretty quick now. Yeah.
In the air, in a mode that's fast enough that, okay, we can take cover, we can evacuate, we can don don protective gear.
Or here's how we treat it.
So sometimes we think that they're all gases, but often they're not. Why don't you take us through a little chemistry lesson here and talk to us about chemical warfare through using three slides about at least 11 of those agents.
So these are the slides that, as I told you, Matt, my staff warned me not to show chemical structures, but I did it anyway. And so oftentimes we think of you know, nerve gas. You call it nerve gas or mustard gas. And I think that came from the early days, so World War I, where they're using chlorine and phosgene and to some extent cyanide. Those are gases.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like a cloud of smoke, and it blows away with the wind, and if, you know, once it's gone, it's gone. However, if you get to things like mustard gas, it's actually a liquid, and it's kind of like syrup. It's thick, and it's kind of oily, and it does not go away quickly, and it's not disseminated as a gas sprayed out of a bottle. It's more of an aerosol or a cloud.
So then it can be on your clothes.
And it won't go away.
Right.
Particularly mustard gas.
Yes.
And some of the others, if you flick to the next slide, the nerve agents are the same way. They're liquids, and they're dispersed as aerosols or mists, and they're much more persistent than some of the, like the old chlorine gases, and they're far more toxic is the other piece is, you know, something, for example, on the far left is GA, and that agent was the first nerve agent that the Germans figured out how to make, and it was very toxic, and it's been replaced by VX now, which is way more toxic, and the one that was supposedly used in the UK is about 10 times more toxic than VX, which is, you know, and they don't go away. They don't. And some of these, for example, the newer ones are solids. They're not even liquids, and so they're dispersed as a powder. The story in the UK, for example, is that the powder was dispersed on the door handles and the doorway of this person's house. You know, just coated on there like a powder coating.
What distinguishes the V series?
They're nasty. Well, they were the next generation of agents. In fact, the V agents really came from the United States. So the Germans were making the G agents, and after World War II, when the Allies kind of realized that the Germans were way ahead of everybody with nerve agents, started to develop their own programs. So what had happened was the German scientists got split up. Some of them got arrested and taken to Russia, and the others got arrested and taken to the Allies, and helped all of us form our program. So the V agents were the next version of the nerve agents. Interestingly enough, almost all the nerve agents, the basic molecules, came from pesticides.
Mm.
So they started as pesticides, and they found out that in the case of the German agents, I think GA is...
Trewyn.
Began
as an insecticide to deal with the need for more food because of the loss of the land to the east.
That's correct. But they found out that it was a humanicide better, because the guy that invented it ended up being in the hospital for weeks and weeks because he practically killed himself.
That's right. Lost his eyesight.
Doing the research.
That's right.
So they're the nerve gas is probably a wrong word to use, but much like tear gas, for example, is not a gas. Tear gas is a powder, but it's dispersed as if it's a gas in a big cloud.
Yeah, yeah. More recently, you were in D.C. In fact, I was at the airport in D.C., and lo and behold, Ron and Dick were there. You had been testifying at the Senate agricultural hearings concerning threats to food security. So what risks are there for us? I know that you... there was some evidence of Al-Qaeda's experimentation on animals. In fact, we have a slide about that. Why don't you talk us through that and talk to us about some of the risks that we experience?
Basically, and Dick is very familiar with this, on the left is the actual list of compounds or of agents, pathogens that Al-Qaeda was planning to work on, and our Navy SEALs going into a cave in Afghanistan in 2002 found that list. And so what's shown next to it, to the right of it, are all the things that are on there. And most people think if you're going to do biological agents, it's just to target people. And of these 16 pathogens listed here, there were 6 targeting people, 6 targeting livestock and poultry, and 4 targeting crops. And essentially every bioweapons program, state-sponsored bioweapons program, has always looked at not just the human agents, but the ones to attack the food supply. And so also in the cave shown below, there were methods to produce this, methods to actually do this and produce them, and I think someone here in the room actually saw some evidence of that.
We saw when the Al-Qaeda left, some of them left Afghanistan, a few puddled up in northern Iraq. I don't think the Iraqis necessarily wanted them there, but it was in a pretty desolate area of Iraq. And through imagery, we could see experiments going on with animals, where they would try different compounds and then run an experiment to see what impact it had on them. I think one of the things we thought they were looking at was ricin, but there were obviously other compounds as well. So I think the thing to take from this chart, that was Afghanistan, that was a long time ago, right? But they're still interested. I think you can look at any of the unclassified information and find out that they're still very interested in coming up with a chemical or biological compound that can cause harm. And we know it can be done. The fact that they haven't done it, more widely is good, but a little bit surprising, frankly.
Yeah. So what might be the consequence? What would be the impact if, you know, some of these things found their ways into animal diseases, for example, or into our plant systems?
Well, I'll start, and then I'll let Ron. Ron's the expert, but he's also the sergeant, so I'm going to start, and then.
That's right. I'll clean up after you.
All sergeants are smarter than the general, but I mean, the impact would be is that our agricultural infrastructure is very vulnerable. We have some surveillance, not very good surveillance. You can drive by a feedlot in any of these central states, and particularly here in Kansas, one of the biggest beef producers in the world because of our feedlots, and you could infect cows with foot and mouth, and it would have a big impact to our food supply, a devastating impact to our economy, and we wouldn't even know it had happened until after the perpetrator or perpetrators were on the next continent, perhaps. So it's very insidious, and that's one of the reasons we were testifying in front of the Senate Agriculture Committee, is trying to raise awareness about our vulnerability to certain pathogens, some of which occur naturally, and some of which terrorist organizations are pursuing. Right. And the free world there's a risk here that we have not fully addressed, I don't think, at this point.
And I would just throw in that any day of the week, there are, livestock being transported everywhere. Mm-hmm. And so by the time you might become aware that something has happened, you have probably transported livestock to multiple states, so you are not going to have a single point of origin necessarily. So you have a national disaster, not just a localized disaster. And there are all sorts of livestock threats on there. Another thing that our plant pathologists like to point out, and United Nations FAO group has up on some of their websites, that roughly 90% of human calories come from 15 plants. And you start looking at that and you go, that's a problem.
Right.
Well, if you look at wheat, rice, and corn, that's about 60% of those three. So you have some pathogen that's going to do in a significant portion of any one of those three, and it's not just a problem for the location, it's a problem for the globe.
Right.
The world is in big, big trouble.
Yeah.
I would add that I was visiting USDA, I was telling these guys beforehand, and I had no idea. We were talking about the number of animals that come across our borders. So not only could they drive up and down, US 70 or 36 and contaminate, they contaminate them in Canada, and a couple days later bring them down. I was shocked at the number, and I can't remember what it was, is how many animals move across our borders.
Millions of animals are on trucks every day, across the country. and symptoms generally aren't going to show up for roughly 4 days, plus or minus, depending on what it is. And so you figure how far that could be disseminated. With many of these diseases, pigs serve as this amplifier where they'll produce 10 times as much virus, so they could just be driving down the road with those and you're spewing virus all over. So there are the consequences. It's so easy, food is so available in this country in particular. We spend so little of our every dollar on food, but some of these things are, you know, could be hugely, hugely problematic, and the economic impacts would be devastating.
Have we had, we knew that there was experimentation happening, that that there's lots of evidence about. Have there been instances where the biological agents have been released and have perhaps begun to take hold and have failed that you're aware of?
Don't know, but I can give you an example that I know the FBI is still trying to figure out, that it was in 2013, porcine epidemic diarrhea virus emerged in three states at almost the identical point in time, right, which sort of suggests it didn't happen by accident. And roughly 8 to 10 million piglets died as a result, and it's now that disease, PEDV, is now endemic in this country. It's pretty clear that that virus came from China. The genetic sequence is 98% homologous, but later in that year there was a new virus that came out that was similar to a virus out of Hong Kong, and later still another one. And so the FBI is still trying to sort out, did this come in here just naturally,
right,
or did somebody use this as a test to see about getting into the system?
Right.
Publication last week or the week before, where Kansas State was on it, they actually know that a number of these things, bacterial and viral, can survive in feed stuffs. And where do we get a lot of the food feed stuffs for animals from around the world?
So I would only say that at least when I was still in uniform, there was a big effort against these groups, Al-Qaeda in particular, because they don't have a lot of expertise, right? They've got one, two, three, six people that might be trained. They might have a chemist or a microbiologist or some folks that are trained that can help to do this. And then the question is, how do you produce it? And then how do you weaponize it? There are problems all the way along, and I think they just don't have the expertise for that. But we would also target that. That little group I talked about went away at some point. So,
with some of the crop pathogens and some of the fungal, a whole variety of things, and even with some of the animal ones, it would be very easy to transport them into this country and not be detected doing it, and there's no risk to the person transporting. And so, there, again, these are issues that people should be concerned about.
Yeah. More recently, Yula and Sergei Skripal were poisoned. Tom, you've mentioned that. Talk to us some more about that, particularly around this question of how do they figure out who did it? There's been some debate about that, of course, but certainly Prime Minister May in the UK has made a declaration.
Yes, the UK has declared that the Russians did it, and so the issue around this particular material is when they first got contaminated and got sick, I think they realized fairly quickly it was some sort of a nerve agent attack. And then the scientists in the UK, so their version of the Edgewood Arsenal or Edgewood Proving Ground is Porton Down, and the Porton Down scientists took samples, probably swabbed the doorway, got blood samples from these two, and they figured out that it was a new version of a nerve agent. So you were asking about the VX,
right,
nerve agents. Well, this new version, they call it Novichok.
And so what would have been their symptoms? We talk about chlorine, there's foaming at the mouth,
sure,
there's burning, the drowning. I understand that Yula was found unconscious on a park bench.
Correct.
What's the effect?
So the effect of the nerve agents are anticholinesterase materials, and so what they do is they inhibit your muscle responses in a variety of ways. And so the symptoms they would face, the first one you face is your pupils will constrict. Mm-hmm. That's the first one. And then after that, it just gets progressively worse. And so you can sweat, you get nausea, you can get shortness of breath with enough that you'll end up getting tremors and convulsions, and eventually you'll lose control. Basically, you lose control of your muscles, and your heart would stop, your lungs would stop, that sort of thing. So they were both found before that all came to conclusion, but they're going to have permanent effects. They do have permanent neurological effects, which they will both have.
So they came in and they did the swabbing. They discovered that it was on their door handles in a variety of places. In fact, here are the teams who are doing that in the suits. More elaborate suit, I might say, than yours, Tom.
They're more colorful.
They are.
we don't spend our money on fluorescent suits. We just use the generic black, white ones.
So talk to more then about how did they figure out it was the Russians.
So they would take it to the laboratory. They would do most likely a technique called gas chromatography, mass spectrometry. It's an analytical chemistry technique, and that would identify it as this specific chemical. So the reason, and that's not particularly novel. We've been doing that kind of technology for years. However, once they figured out it was that chemical, what's known is the Russians were the only ones that are known to have that material, because it was specifically known to the Russians. And so that's where
the
British came out.
Wouldn't it have been fair to say, but in order for you to know that it's ours, the Russian might say, you've got to have some to compare it to.
Yes, that's a reasonable expectation. And I would guess that it's likely that the Port and Down folks have what they would call a reference material of that, as much as they would have VX and VG and GA in their laboratories.
And there's a molecular signature?
Correct. That's correct. And they can compare the signature and get a result. And so the argument, of course, is that either the Russians did it, or the Russians gave it to somebody else who did it, or the Russians lost control of it, and then whoever got it did it. And the Russians are, of course, saying that's not the case. But in the end, I think, as a chemist, I'm pretty satisfied that the material they identified is probably, because one of the neat things, and this is one of the, from my perspective as a chemist, that I revel in compared to the biologists, is that the business of identifying chemical warfare agents is far easier to do than identifying biological materials, because the biological materials can look an awful lot like things that aren't harmful. So for example, there's anthrax, I think it's a Stearns version that's right. Not harmful, and then there's other versions right. That are very harmful. Whereas there's no not harmful Novichok.
Right.
They're all, it's pretty certain. If they said they found it, I'm pretty confident
okay.
that they found it.
So here's a question for us all. Why the heck weren't they just shot? Someone could have come in at night and shot them in their beds and disappeared, and that would have been it. They would have had the same effect of extinguishing the Russian spy who was also working for the Brits. Why wouldn't they just shoot them?
Well, the next time that happens, somebody's going to come looking at you for suggesting it.
I think it's quite Russian. I think they would like something like this. I think as a method, because the impact is so draconian on the subjects here, there'd be suffering involved. That's kind of bullet would be it'd be over, and this. As you mentioned, will probably go on I guess they're going to survive, but for the rest of their lives. So I think they wanted that kind of, if they survive, that kind of punishment. I don't know. It's they've done things like it before, so it's not unusual.
Yeah, I think in a lot of cases they're making a point.
Yeah, there's a bigger point here than just, yeah.
Good, we're going to come back to that. So, Dick, after 9/11, what were your concerns, and what was the U.S. government's concern around chemical agents? in the days after the 9/11 attacks?
Well, the first concern was around anthrax. As you may remember, right after 9/11, there were several envelopes with anthrax that were sent to various offices in Washington, D.C., to the Senate office building. In fact, Tom Daschle, Senate Majority Leader, got an envelope with anthrax in it. I think it killed at least one postal worker in one of the postal distribution centers. And it was not from, it was from folks that probably weren't thinking right, but I'm not sure it was a terrorist organization, as I remember.
It turned out to be, it would appear at least, it's never been found, but it turned out to be potentially an individual. American.
Yep.
And so, but at the time, though, that wasn't known.
That wasn't known.
So what was the talk in?
Well, so the talk in the town was, gee, if we're going to go to Afghanistan, if the troops are going to go to Afghanistan, how are we going to protect them? And there's a vaccine for anthrax that veterinarians have been using for decades. And so the idea was, we'll inoculate all American troops, you know, at that time, 1.4 million men and women, and then the reservists, which is another million at that time, so about everybody would get their inoculation. Anthrax requires either a series of six or seven shots, and I started down that series. Then the plant failed. The plant failed FDA inspections, so they couldn't do it anymore. And while the plant was shut down, then there was a lot of comments on the internet that this vaccine is unsafe, it's unhealthy, it causes other symptoms. Interesting little sidelight, as Secretary Rumsfeld was trying to decide what to do, the Joint Chiefs of Staff had said, we understand all that, we need to vaccinate, and we'll just mandate everybody gets their vaccination. Secretary Rumsfeld wasn't too sure about that. You know, he was CEO of G.D. Searle, a pharmaceutical company, so he was a little more skeptical about maybe the ill effects of anthrax. And he had a Nobel Prize-winning virologist come to the Pentagon, and we sat around a table and asked the Nobel Prize-winning virologist, is this vaccine effective, and does it have risk? And he said, yes, it's effective, and all vaccines have risk, but when you think about the risk balance, risk-reward here, you'd want to vaccinate. And I said, boy, that settles that. Well, Secretary Rumsfeld wasn't satisfied with that answer from the Nobel, so he kept doing his own surveys out in the halls of the Pentagon. I don't think he really wanted to do it, but the military felt that, you know, it's all vaccines have risk, right? Yeah. But to some degree, on some people. But this was, we thought, the right thing to do for our troops, because we thought we might be. It was a fairly easy compound to spread around, so we eventually decided that was the case. But it was interesting, actually.
Yeah.
But we tried to. We were thinking, how do we protect our troops? That was the whole deal.
And so, Tom, in those months after 9/11, what was MRIGlobal's response? How were you brought into this?
Well, there were two ways. The first way was that we engaged in a program in response to that anthrax attack, which was to help protect the capital region for further biological attacks. So doing, and we continue to do it today in the DC area, which is to monitor for, you know, threat materials.
So there are detectors around the DC area sniffing the air, figuring if there's traces of biological or chemical agents.
Yeah.
Chemical agents.
Yes, in essence, that's correct. And the other piece is that we began, so not long after that, as we engaged more and more in the Middle East trying to clean up in Iraq, which was to support that mission and the destruction of their chemical stockpile. And so in that regard, that's when we started to mobilize and put together field laboratories that could go and support that mission in the field versus having to wait for samples to get back into the United States. And so we started doing that mission. That really initiated for us the kind of the mobile laboratory operations that we continue today.
Yeah.
So just right after 9/11, in my office, the Pentagon, a little device, little container about that big stood up in the corner of my office and kind of hummed along, and My assumption was he put it there, but it was. I think it was an air sample. I don't know. Nobody ever told me. They said, it's okay, boss, we're just going to leave it right there. And somebody probably changed filters every so often, but that's what that was all about. Yeah. So it's serious, and those are the kind of measures you take, actually.
And the biologist in the room needs to say, you will find biologicals everywhere in the air, so it's the nasty ones you're worried about.
The chemicals. So let's talk, we've talked about the chemicals, some of the biological elements, the zoonotic diseases.
Okay.
So Ron, talk to us about that. We have this spectacular chart here.
Oh, that shows up pretty good.
Yes. Yeah. So what are these natural disease outbreaks that are risks for us?
All right, and I'll start with what those are and then get to the zoonotic part. So basically what's shown here is in a 22-month period, natural disease outbreaks around the world only of pathogens that CDC or USDA regulate. There are many more pathogens out there, but these are particularly problematic ones. There are 42 on this list, and so when I show this, my major point is just through the movement of people and goods, a lot of these things are going to get here. We saw the Al-Qaeda list before, but these things are out there, and there are a lot of them. Seven of these, of the 42, are on the expected list that NBAF will work on, which now includes Ebola and Nipah virus that killed a million pigs and 150 people in Malaysia back in the 90s, both with biosafety level 4 diseases for which there's no treatment, so to work on livestock on those, you need this. So to the zoonotic, which both of those are, so essentially if you have zoonotic diseases that can spread from animals to people, we've seen a lot of examples with that, with bird flu and whatnot recently, H5N1 and a whole variety of others. And there are all sorts of variations of those where there are outbreaks in various parts of the world. You see, Africa and Asia are where an awful lot of these, sort of the epicenter. These things are out there, and what our troops have found, they go into various parts of the world where people seem to be healthy. All of a sudden, they're getting sick with diseases they didn't know existed because there's an innate immunity in the population that lives there, but you bring in outsiders, they're getting sick with various diseases. So these are big issues. This is another big reason why NBAF is so important, getting that operational and being able to start targeting these.
Yeah, you know, it was 100 years ago, wasn't it, that the flu of 1919, or that would be 1918, excuse me, killing between 50 and 100 million people.
Yes.
So now, of course, the world's population is that much larger, but how would we cope with 100 million people being killed through one of these diseases, and the consequence for us, it would be terrifying.
Well, and just as an aside, one of my father's siblings died that year. My mother always told the story that at 8 years old, she had to carry food out to her father who couldn't come out of the barn or they wouldn't be able to sell her milk. If he came into the house, they couldn't sell, so she would carry food out to him to the barn in 1918. So this was a big deal. There is a Kansas connection, but I saw a recent thing where it probably wasn't Fort Riley. It may have actually been Eskridge, I think, County, where some people went from there, so there were some things that happened. But there is a Kansas connection to where that may have started.
Yeah. Let's talk about Syria. 5 years after President Assad agreed to purge Syria's chemical weapons stockpile, chemical warfare shows no end. And here is the list of attacks that was printed in the New York Times today. Seven usages of chemical agents since 2013. Sarin, poison gas. I don't know what that one was, Tom. Chlorine, mustard gas, chlorine, sarin, and at least the New York Times today was unwilling to state the agent, just simply calling it a chemical agent. You know, for me, the question is, why do people poison their own? What's the purpose of this?
My opinion in this particular case is there's two parts. I think because this is, they're trying to put down revolutionaries or, you know, a civil war in essence. It's a fear tactic, and they're showing that they can exert their power even in the case today where they have very little power left. That's my take. Why you would choose to gas just anybody is just not fathomable. You know, I mean, it's not fathomable on a war, in a battlefield scenario, and then to put it in this kind of scenario. If you've seen the pictures from this most recent one, there's lots of men, women, and children.
Right.
In fact, the first report I read said the first attack came on a hospital of all things.
And so, this would be a war crime if done in warfare. It's not appropriate under the law of armed conflict, which tries to put some rules on war, which is, as people know, really difficult. But this would be a war crime. So if somebody authorized this in wartime, if we'd have done that in Iraq or Afghanistan, you could be held accountable for a war crime. Why we're not holding Assad responsible for this, I don't know. It's just it's the world has let a lot of those pictures are. I don't know about you, but I can't. I mean, when they come on, I can't watch them. I've got kids that age, and this is not right. And why the world isn't responding in a more forceful way? I mean, we drew a red line somewhere in there in the past president, and we didn't follow through. There's been a lot of talk. The other thing I would say is, you know, you get mad, you want to do something. That's not enough. You got to have kind of a strategy for where you want to go.
So what should we not do in this instance?
Well, I think any... So we saw after... we were going after... What were the factories we were after that we put the cruise missiles on in the Clinton regime? In Sudan and other places. Remember they were...
Yep.
What were we going after... chemical capability.
Yep.
And that was kind of seen as a pinprick, and you don't really care because you're not putting your blood and treasure at risk. You're using ships far out at sea with cruise missiles, and adversaries said they don't really care. They're going to spend their money and their technology, but that's they got a lot more than that. They're not spending that. So I think something has to be done that would be meaningful, but that you'd have a strategy for where this is going to lead.
Right.
And I think just striking to make ourselves feel better, unless there's some strategy behind that, a longer term strategy, which is going to ask for the world to be involved somehow. The world's going to have to be involved. This is intolerable. Why we sit here in Kansas City having wine and cheese and there are folks gasping for life. We're just sitting here as a country and the whole West is sitting there, and all the Middle East. I don't get it, and it makes you madder in heck. You want to do something, but it better have some rationale and some strategy behind it than just playing whack-a-mole with this idiot.
Yeah, we're getting close to our time. I want to ask just a couple of questions, Tom. Does the U.S. still use or have chemical agents as a weapon?
So the U.S. does not use them. They agreed, we signed on to the Chemical Weapons Convention and eventually ratified that, which required us to get rid of our stockpile. Now, as we just discussed, the Syrians signed on to that same convention. It didn't seem to stop them. So we've been on a mission of destroying our stockpile, which was large,
right.
Very large stockpile. After World War II, we amassed a lot of chemical weapons. So we're well over 90% destroyed, and I think the target is, in fact, I think we'll be destroyed about the time NBAF opens. But 2023 is the target. There's two plants left that are actively destroying agent. One is in Pueblo, Colorado, and the other is Bluegrass, Kentucky. And they're both actively working away. So we have no active programs other than programs to develop, you know, protection, detection, collection, that sort of thing.
Dick, we hear it said that all options should be on the table. Should the U.S. have stockpiles of chemical and biological agents? Should we keep that as one of our options?
No. We made that decision back in the 90s, signed the convention, said we were never going to use them, and... You know, I think a lot of the world looks to the United States for our views and our opinions. And if we're going to have the moral high ground, we've got to be clean. And no, we can't. And it's the world has decided that at one point, just because they're used in Syria. And we've known Syria's had a program. In fact, there's several countries, more than several, that have programs. We know about that. North Korea's one, chemical, biological. Syria, chemical, biological. We know that. We've seen the testing. We've watched it from satellites. The same kind of test grounds that you saw on Tom's chart, we've seen those testing facilities and other intelligence. So we know that's going on, but that doesn't mean we should do it. It's the same argument you get when you're dealing with terrorists who are not playing in accordance with the Geneva Conventions. I gave several lectures where somebody in the crowd says, "Well, why don't we just nuke them?" Well. I mean, it was a serious comment. They were serious. You know, it's so frustrating to deal with people that don't play by the rules. But our job is, I think, as the United States of America anyway, is to try the best we can, and we're not perfect for sure, but try to keep the moral high ground and lead others to that path. And maybe we can avoid more Assads at some point.
Now, we've really coming full circle then, when gas was first used in 1915, as I opened, by being released from cylinders because it didn't contravene the convention of the day, which said that chemical agents weren't permitted to be used in artillery, and so they were used instead, released from cylinders as a way around that. Of course, very soon after that first use, both sites were using chemical weapons. Then to a circumstance where we find ourselves today, where we're doing all that we can to do away with chemical weapons and biological weapons, but the risk still remains. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your participation this evening. Our conversation tonight is in part because we have this extraordinary work, John Singer Sargent Gassed, perhaps one of the most significant works to come out, artworks to come out of World War I, which we have here for a number of months yet, and we'd invite you to come back and see that, which is paired with objects. So ordinarily this work is paired with art, and it's really quite a striking experience to see it paired with the gas masks that these young men, remembering their 18, 19, 20-year-olds, carried with them. And so we'd invite you to come back and see the galleries. The enduring impact of World War I is forever with us. And so your support of this museum and memorial enables us to do this sort of work here in Kansas City, and in fact, with our peers right across the globe. Please join me in thanking our panelists, Dr. Tom Sack, General Richard Myers, Dr. Ron Trewyn. Thank you and good night. Thank you.